Right, members, this is 8th meeting of the both Committee on Interception of Communications and Surveillance Amendment Bill 2015. We have a quorum and we've reached the appointed hour. Let us invite officials into the room. The first item on the agenda, of course, is to discuss with the administration on matters which are of concern to members. On the in response to the questions raised by members on the 29th of June, the administration has given a written reply, paper number CB2-1879/1415-01. Well, it is quite a detailed reply to the questions raised by members. I'd like to see if the Deputy Secretary wants to add anything to the paper, and then I will see if members have any questions. I hope that after discussing the questions, the Bills Committee can proceed to studying the bill clause by clause. I think we do have quite detailed discussions on various issues. The Deputy Secretary. Well, Chairman, we have nothing special to add to the paper. As for the destruction of the products of interception, we have already answered members' questions. We understand members' concerns, and we have also given a further explanation to our view. So I have nothing more to add. All right. Any questions from members? James Toh, Sin Chung Kai. Okay, 5 minutes each. Mr. James Toh, Chairman. Now, the meeting was the 29th of July. The previous meeting was the 29th of July. It was rather technical. Is it possible for them to take us through the paper? Now, we have come to a rather technical stage. I think they should highlight the salient points in the paper. Yes, members hope that you can highlight the major points in your paper. Yes, thank you, Chairman, and thank you, Mr. Toh. Well, let me go over the main points in the paper. The first paragraph deals with, or the first section deals with the checking of protected products by the Commissioner. On the whole, the destruction arrangement is for the purpose of protecting privacy. And the products, the protected products, have to be destroyed within a reasonable period of time. Under certain exceptions. Number one, the retention of the protected products for inspection by the commissioner. The other is that there is a need in the judicial process for such products. After the judicial process, the products will be destroyed as soon as possible. The LEAs, after conducting 1 month after the completion of the operation, will destroy the intercepted products. Now, as for the summaries and extracts of the products, of the intercepted products, when there is no further need for use, then the materials will be destroyed as soon as possible. Well, unless the commissioner asks for retention of such materials. And the same applies to the judicial process. Our proposal in the bill is to authorize the commissioner to have direct access to protected products or to intercepted products. We have spelled out in the amendment bill that the LEAs will have to fine-tune their policy in respect of destroying protected products. The commissioner should be enabled to come into to have access to such materials according to the bill. And once the commissioner has completed his task, then the products will be, the protected products will be destroyed. Therefore, in paragraph 3, we say that the material will have to be destroyed as soon as its retention is not necessary for the purpose of prescribed authorization or for compliance of any further requirements imposed by the commissioner. Mr. Chairman, in response to a question raised by Mr. Toh, and that is whether the commissioner can designate that the protected products within a certain period of time will have obtained within a period of time will have to be kept for a designated period of time. If there is such a requirement, then the commissioner, LEAs will have to comply with the requirement. Under Section 53, the commissioner may require the provision of any protected products within in the manner specified by the commissioner. Now, the protected products are confidential, and we don't want the products kept for a long time so as to enhance the risk of leakage. We believe that the commissioner and his office will not use the product for investigation of crimes or for purposes outside the remit of the commissioner. And the commissioner will not designate the LEAs to keep protected products for a very long period of time. Mr. Chairman, I have highlighted the response in pages 1 to 3, on pages 1 to 3. Yes, Mr. James Toa, let me ask the questions one by one. In the first paragraph, I don't understand. For intercept products of which the commissioner had not made any request for preservation, they were destroyed in accordance with the requirements of Section 59 of the Ordinance. They were or they will be? Well, the question is about the current situation, whether LEAs have kept products for the access of the commissioner or inspection of the commissioner. So you just refer to historical products. Those that are not necessary have been destroyed. You did ask whether the products were destroyed or were kept. Yes, indeed. Now, in the past, did the commissioner ask for retention of certain protected products? Did he have to specify the requirement in writing? Were only those concerns listed those related to the concerns listed in the report kept, or other products kept upon the request of the Commissioner, Mrs. Ng. Thank you, Chairman. Thank you, Mr. To. Now, even if in the report of the Commissioner a certain case, the material of certain case had be had to be kept, in fact, the Commissioner did give instruction to the keeping of certain products in writing, and the LEAs also complied with the requirement of the Commissioner. The protected products are kept maybe until the passage of the bill so that the Commissioner can conduct inspections on those products. And now, according to the previous reports by the Commissioner, many issues were related to LPP products. Were they kept? PS. Yes, Mr. To's understanding is correct. Such information has been kept. Now, in the second paragraph, it is said that the Commissioner may require any LEA officer to provide and protect products in possession or control of the Commissioner pursuant to Section 531A any time before the protected product is destroyed under Section 591C. What is the relationship between destruction and the requirement made by the Commissioner? What do you mean? Well, to put it simply, you may. I will have to ask later. You say, for the LEAs, as for the LEAs, they destroy the products within a month. It's said here, paragraph 6. At present, the originals of intercept products are normally destroyed within 1 month from interception. Well, let's assume that it's 1 month. With regard to this 1 month, how does it relate to the requirement made by the Commissioner for keeping the product? According to the reports, it's really unlikely that within a month the Commissioner has found that it is problematic.
Now, we're talking about 1 month after the operation. To be destroyed, not referring to those the Commissioner has asked to be kept, only those that the Commissioner did not ask to keep will be destroyed within 1 month. Now, so am I right in saying that the Commissioner could actually request for retention of, let's say, several months, so that he has more time, and this will bypass the 1 month requirement. Now, the policy for destruction of materials is something that the Commissioner is aware of, and he could actually work within the month. So this 1 month period is acceptable by the Commissioner. Now, but after the passage of the bill, the Commissioner will liaise with the LEAs as to how to adjust the 1 month period. There is a possibility that the 1 month can be extended to allow the Commissioner more time. Now, can you please answer the question directly? Is the Commissioner empowered to extend the time limit under the amendment? Yes, I'm just supplementing the question for you because your time is really over. Now, according to our amended version, the Commissioner can have the power to do so. Now, I would like to ask about page 4 Okay, now on page 4, paragraph 11 and 12. Now, I don't know whether I understand this correctly. Now, the LEAs are not willing to give us the statistics. Am I right, Deputy Secretary? Now, we have consulted the LEAs, and number one, in their day-to-day enforcement work, now, for warrants or to get witness statements, now, these would not result in any statistics being compiled. Now, if they have to compile statistics, they feel that it is not necessary. Now, we have considered from our angle the issue of warrants is outside the scope of the bill. So that's why we've stated our stance for members. So the LEAs are not helping us to compile statistics, but they have no plan to compile statistics. So they refuse to help us scrutinize the bill. Now, I think, as I said earlier, the number of warrants lies outside the scope of the bill. It's not that we are standing in the way of members scrutinizing the bill. They are just two separate issues. Now, if you look at the paragraph, that it has no value for formulating fight crime strategies, but it will have a power to help us monitor the work of the government. Am I right? Now, the LEAs would handle a lot of procedures. Getting warrants is one thing, and then the court also has a role to play, whether to allow warrants to be granted or not. Now, Secretary, now you are devising policies, and you are here to help us scrutinize the bill. Now, I am raising this request not just by myself, but other members too. And last time we had a consensus. Now, is the LEA or are they willing to help us? I feel that you have the responsibility to convince the LEAs to help electrical members because you are submitting the bill for scrutiny. You should tell them, okay, from their angle, the statistics have no value for formulating fight crime strategies, but they are helpful for scrutinizing the bill because they their task is to fight crime, but our task is to scrutinize the bill. Now, on the issue of warrants, Secretary, there are quite a few members asking for this. It may not be a general consensus, but you have asked the LDAs, and their response is that they are not going to give those statistics. Chair, the answer is certain. We have consulted, and if we were to compile statistics, it's going to take time, and it also lies outside the scope of the bill. I am not happy with this reply. I hope the LDAs will come forward to tell us why they are not helping us to scrutinize the bill. Is it something that they really should be doing? Claudia Mo. Now, just following on the previous discussion, apart from helping us scrutinize the bill, this is also a public right to know. Now, the wording is that they do not have any such statistics. But now it's we are told that they are not compiling statistics. Okay, maybe they have destroyed those statistics. Well, the paper says that LDAs do not maintain statistics. But is it the case that they just keep a record. They just add together. We are not asking them to do any sophisticated statistics. It's just a matter of giving us the total figure. Oh, as the Security Bureau, I feel that you have the responsibility to tell them that from now on, these figures have to be kept. As the word you use, they have to be maintained. So this is my question and comment. I hope you will answer it. And I don't know whether this is a translation from English to Chinese. It's really very, very difficult to read. I have to read three or four times before I can understand it. But it's still very difficult to understand. Okay, so there is a one-month period, and they will be destroyed unless requested by the commissioner. Now, is it a subjective judgment by the commissioner? Now, of course, he is assisted by different colleagues. Now, you use the word acceptable by the commissioner. I do not find that really acceptable. It's, well, if you say the commissioner is very happy, very satisfied with 1 month period, then that is better. Then can you talk to him and say that we shorten it to 21 days? Maybe he would also find it acceptable, but he would find it hard-pressed or a bit short for time. Now, the earlier question about 1 month being extended, that would be a possibility. Now, the follow-up question arises, so when would that become possible? And why is there a possibility of the one-month period be extended? Now, my third question, now to use your logic, there should not be any limit on the duration. In other words, the materials will be kept unless told by the commissioner that they would no longer be needed. Now, the crux of the bill is that the material should be destroyed ASAP, and that's the spirit of the bill, am I right? Yes. Okay. Now, on the issue of warrants, I have no further addition. Sorry, Chairman, when you say that there's nothing to add, well, you are representing the Security Bureau, that LegCo has such a request, and also the public has a right to know. And these figures will also help the LegCo members to scrutinize the bill. Well, she's sitting here as the Security Bureau. Now, because last time we asked her to get the figures, so I think let her finish answering the other questions first. Deputy Secretary. Now, if Madam Mo is not entirely happy with the first question, then I can, of course, say it again. Now, our stance is whenever possible, we will comply with members' requests and to give you as detailed an answer as possible. Now, for warrants, I understand that the LegCo will also get such warrants, and we've also consulted the LEAs, and you can see that they have their own difficulties in terms of resources and manpower. Now, it's not that the figures are not there. Now, for each and every case, they would get more than one warrant or more than once. And for the different districts, they would have warrants in the various districts of the territory. And then they have to put those figures together if you request them. And then the LEAs are already doing quite a lot on the figures, particularly regarding the trends of crimes and the monitoring of crimes. And these crime statistics are prepared periodically for electrical members on searching individuals and whether policemen are in debt and so on. Now, so the message that I received, and I'm frankly relaying to members, they really have difficulties compiling those figures, so I cannot really give you my word. Now, your second question on the 1 month after interception. Now, the issue has been running for the past 9 years, and if you destroy the evidence after 1 month, this is something they've been doing for the LDAs unless requested by the commissioner or required by the courts. Now, this arrangement has been pretty good. Now, after the passage of the bill, there may be such changes, and the commissioner would have the right to have access to the original materials. And the commissioner, because they have to get in touch with the original, and you have to give him time to do that, so there will be discussion for the director of the departments to facilitate the work of the commissioner, to give him the chance to do his work. Now, the third question, whether the bill would allow the materials to be kept indefinitely. Now, I'm afraid that is not possible, because under Clause 59, these protected materials, unless they are to be under the prescribed authority. Now, otherwise, these materials, most of them would be very sensitive, would be destroyed as soon as possible, and they would not be kept indefinitely. No, but to strike a balance, Chair, now, if these are protected, then they should be destroyed ASAP. Then can you not make it or shorten it to 14 days or half a month so that there will be more people helping the commissioner do his work? Mr. Yu, now, on warrants, now, I raised my point last time. LegCo, asking for figures from the LDAs. Now, what is the purpose of that? And when you have the figures, and by doing so, you are creating additional work for the LDAs, well, we have to be very careful. Now, if we have the figures, let's say 10,000 cases, and then the judiciary approved 95%, and then you will raise a query, then maybe the judiciary is being too lenient.
On the other hand, say if the LEAs have made 10,000 applications and only 70% of the applications were approved, then would the LEAs be too ready to apply for warrants? We need to consider what's the purpose of doing that. Do you intend to put pressure on these two departments, or do you want to show you have the power to ask for statistics? What's the point of having these statistics? I hope members should explain that. Well, if I ask for the numbers and you can't provide the numbers, then you don't respect the council. I don't think that's the right thinking. You need to consider what's your purpose, and in doing so, would that facilitate the operation of the various parties? The second question is about retention of the products for 1 month. before destruction. Now the that is the presumption of innocence. And there is a need to destroy it, to destroy the intercepted products as soon as possible, otherwise it will be unfair to the subject. The longer the period of keeping the products, the longer the accumulation of the materials and documents, the less favorable would that be to the subject. There is a chance of leakage. There is a chance of the material being stolen. The products shouldn't be kept indefinitely. And that's the importance of the rule of law. I think it is for the commissioner to consider whether 1 month is enough. I want to ask, after the law has been in operation for so many years, has the commissioner asked for keeping the materials for a longer period of time? Is it an often request? And is there, are there any numbers, specific numbers? We don't have any specific numbers, but over the years, in respect of the reports by the commissioner has been generally satisfied with the work done by the LEAs. As long as the commissioner asks, then the LEAs will keep the documents for checking by the commissioner. Therefore, the commissioner has not made any higher requirements. Mr. Yeo, I think we need to respect the commissioner because this is a suggestion by the commissioner for improving the operation of the regime. We should consider the need of the commissioner. We shouldn't make too many guesses. Mr. Wong Yongman, this is a response to the questions raised on the 29th of June. We have identified this problem. The administration now proposes to change the law, though it has been dragging its feet for many years, and you're just going through the motion. Many crucial issues have not been dealt with by this amendment bill, and there aren't checks and balances on those LEAs. Our concern is about the limit of the power. We give a duty to the commissioner or an office, and then we also give the commissioner the power. Or rather, we give the LEAs the power, and then there is the problem of abuse by LEAs in exercising such powers, and the commissioner has no check or balance, neither check nor balance. Now, in para 11, to consider requiring LEAs to maintain statistics for the coming 3 months on respective numbers of approved and rejected applications for search warrants. The administration's answer is it's none of its business. The attitude is really disappointing. Now, in the report of the commissioner, it is said that 1,412 prescribed authorizations given. And then the administration also said the LEAs sought information from ISPs up to 4,300-odd times. That is WeChat, Line, WhatsApp. You don't need to intercept communication. Just go to the ISPs. Give us the data. Give us a record, then, and they will yield. So you do that. So the getting the information copies from ISPs, the occasions are three times more than interception of communication. I look at the numbers. It is very scary. power is unchecked. Now, the amendment does not cover this area. Your position is very strong. You will not do this. We are discussing an outdated law. The scope of amendment is so small. It is useless. Even you give more power to the commissioner to have access to protected products, there is no need to do so. Say the law enforcement agencies don't need that. The WhatsApp leak example of the leak of WhatsApp messages of the pro-establishment is a good example. What's the point of having this amendment? We ask for the number of warrants. You say application to court for search warrants are made under different ordinances and relate to the investigation of a wide variety of crimes, and the court is the authority for approving applications for search warrants. Well, in fact, you have not addressed the question, Mr. Chairman, the Deputy Secretary. Well, in fact, the administration is impartial. We are willing to work with the commissioner and also the council in this amendment. If you look at the bill, in different places, the law provides for the checks and balances of the powers of the LEAs in doing covert surveillance or interception of communications. The LEAs have to comply with the law, and if they haven't done anything beyond the permission of the law, then they will have to face the dire consequences. In fact, there is protection. Say the disclosure is to be minimal, the number of copies made should be minimal, the number of persons in contact with the information should be minimal, so on and so forth, and the materials have to be destroyed ASAP. The law has been there for 9 years, and you can see the achievements. Between interception and warrants, will the LEAs get around the supervision by the commissioner and go for application of warrants? In fact, in investigating a case, you may need different strategies. Sometimes you need a warrant to obtain information to be produced in the court. At some stages, you need covert surveillance. With regard to interception of communication and application of warrants, they are two different things. With regard to covert surveillance and interception of communication, they are very effective in terms of getting intelligence for investigating crimes. The LEAs use such powers commonly. Mr. James Ho. Chairman, I have been a legislative member for many years, and I have never imagined that they can give an answer like this. Probably the police has nothing to fear at all. Now, LEAs do not maintain statistical figures on the number of applications for search warrants and the results of these applications. It has not been the practice of LEAs to maintain statistics on the procedures taken during crime investigation, as they have no value for formulating fight crime strategies. Well, they have many people doing statistics, crime statistics. They are not just for investigation. The statistics can also be a way to monitor the performance of the police, as said by the secretary just now. In the past, after the police arrested a person and then conduct a body search, the Lao Sanqing incident, he was asked to jump and also sex workers arrested by police, and and body search was conducted. The police resisted to provide statistics on body search by the done by the police. After debating it back and forth for 2 years, the police finally agreed that it was important to maintain the numbers. In fact, after that, the number of such body searches declined by 90%. It is a magic number. Once the statistics are kept, and then the number of such activities has declined. Why? Because the police has to consider very carefully whether there is such a need. And up till now, the police say, the police says that their law enforcement has not been affected. The keeping of numbers is not just limited to fight crime strategies. As for this search warrant to obtain information from ISPs, if you don't keep the statistics, then you really can't explain, say, in the long term, as said by Mr. Wong Yuk Man. If the number of warrants for ISPs rising, and then interception application to the commissioner, made to the commissioner, is declining, Then that will be a cause of concern. You don't need instant interception of information. You can just go to the court, get the warrant, and then get the ISP's records. Now, we have Chapter 1, Protection of Journalistic Materials. It is because of the public's concern towards freedom of the press. In terms of studying the law, in terms of monitoring the performance of the police, this is really necessary. It is a statutory process. There is no secret at all. Now, you can have a rough estimate of the number of cases under which warrants are applied. I have not asked you to do much additional work. Say, for example, now if you say you go through a process, you need an hour, but if you you just input the numbers, then you need to say 2 hours, then of course that is not effective. But as for application for a warrant, I have talked to LEA officers. I think they told me that the longest was to make the affidavit. If you ask me just to put in two numbers, that is not very complicated at all. If such a request is rejected, then the commissioner should resign. That's bad attitude.
It's only two entries. Deputy Secretary, now after listening to Mr. To, what is your response? Chair, I respect members' views, obviously. And we have actually asked the LDAs. And even if you say that out of the thousands of files and to maintain the figures, it may not affect the number of warrants to be applied for in the future. Now, there are many ways to monitor the police, and the warrants are, whether it's issued or not, are decided by the court. Not just the proportion, but the overall figure is also important. Now, I have also explained that the LDAs, they handle many cases every day. And if for every type of case, Well, warrant is one of the procedure. I'm told we have a real difficulty, and there would be resource implications. Now, can you tell me, quantify, how many more minutes or seconds do you need to compile such an entry? I find this really not acceptable. Now, whether or not the commissioner will resign or not is for the commissioner to decide, but can you relay the view that the member of LegCo has strong request to have such figures? So this has been stated very clearly. Okay. Claudia Mo, and then Mr. Mok. Thank you, Chair. Now, the executive branch and the legislative branch are two separate and autonomous bodies. Now, LegCo wants to have some figures, and if not for the past, then well, at least for the future. Now, a LegCo member now is saying that why should we be having such figures? Now, I find this very strange. This is creating pressure on the various government bodies. I find this very, very interesting. Now, what is the point of journalism now? What is the point of having things like public right to know? Well, I mean, why stop this before it's being produced? I was just saying that you should just keep a record of the numbers. Now, if you say that even that is complicated, then I really have nothing to say. Now, the government should really adopt a neutral stance now, and in your discharging of your duties, you should be transparent. Now, Chair, I agree that while we are doing the scrutiny of the bill, we should achieve some sort of check and balance. So let me just reiterate my earlier point. Now, your paragraph 3, now the end of paragraph 3, you say, well, you've given me worry, room for worry. That explains my earlier question, because the wording is really very strange. Now, it says that any requirement that any protected product should be provided to commissioner would override, the word override in bold, the requirement to destroy the protected product when it is no longer necessary for the relevant purpose of the prescribed authorization. Now, I have read this sentence three or four times. Now, am I understanding this right? And if people are not familiar with this, they will not know what is being said here. You stress the word override. So what is the underlying spirit of this sentence? Now, in the past, well, people have been expressing concern about whether the commissioner has power over the protected product or its destruction. So this is a very important concept of the commissioner having the right to override. Mr. Chairman, I believe you have actually answered part of my question. Well, the law aims to strike a balance. So to protect privacy on the one hand, and that LEAs can enforce operation on the other, and under the scrutiny of the commissioner. So we're trying to achieve a balance here. Now, at the moment, the law is very clear. In Section 59, it says that if the protected product is no longer necessary, the aim of the prescribed authorization is no longer there, then the product should be destroyed ASAP. But now we are amending the law, and we want to empower the commissioner to get in touch with the original material. So if we follow Section 59 without any amendment, then the prescribed authorization's goal is not there, is no longer matching, then the product has to be destroyed. But now it is saying that because the protected product has to do with the JM or LPP, then the commissioner has the right to protect that product, even though your overall goal is to destroy ASAP. Now, but the point is not that the commissioner has full right to do everything he likes. That would not happen, because the commissioner has to protect and respect privacy. Okay, so the bill actually is to give more power to the commissioner. Mr. Mok. Now, Mr. James Toh was saying that if the Commissioner of Police is not willing to provide figures, then he should resign. Now, if Mr. Toh really wants to do that, then maybe the DOJ and the Commissioner for Secretary for Security will also be facing the same situation, and you're asking them to provide figures, if not for the past, then for the future. Now, if we follow Mr. Toh's logic, then all these officials will have to resign. Now, I believe that you have the right to ask them to do things, and then they have the right to provide information. And I find this very strange that they are refused to provide figures. Now, Chair, for the Internet ISPs, they are very much concerned about this, and they have a lot of complaints raised recently. And the police sometimes has warrants, sometimes they don't have warrants, and ask them for information. And sometimes they will ask for a whole hard disk. And the ISPs find this very troublesome. And it's not protecting the privacy of the consumers. And they are producing a form for the police to fill out before they can get those information. And with this form in place, the police is asking for more warrants. So the moral of the story is you are forcing them, and then they will properly ask for warrants. So that's why we're asking for figures. But now you're telling us that there are no figures. But the trade wants these figures to have objective comparison. We're only asking you to do it from now on. And if you say no, then are we going to go back to the trade? And then we ask them, how many warrants have you received so far? Now, so all our requests are met with the answer no. And the LEAs, the police, are not giving us figures. So are you telling us that we can only go to the trade and then to ask whether the number is in the hundreds or in the thousands? Now, we are not going anywhere, Mr. Chairman. But I really don't know what to do. I just want to describe the crux of the matter, that this information is really important. Unlike what another member has said, that this is not important. Well, we have to know the picture. And I can also relate the view of the trade. Now, some people say that I don't represent the trade, but I'm not saying that the trade is very concerned about this. But then the government is not really cooperating. Deputy Secretary, Chair, Now, I believe I understand the difficulty of the department. They are doing a lot of figures, and for the LEAs, regarding crime trends, they have put in a lot of resources and manpower to produce those figures. And for figures released to the public, they have to make a special effort to collect those figures, a number of visits, and also, as I said earlier, video taking, death by policemen, and so on. The list is endless. So it is not true to say that there are no resource implications. But how much additional resources are needed? Now, I think it's difficult to quantify for Mr. Mok, but I understand your concern. Now, can I really do more? Now, the question, Mr. Chairman, I have to say that there is really not much more I can do. So, Mr. Mok, no matter what we say, and you don't know how much you can do, and you don't know how much resources are needed. So what sort of reason is that? Now, I think Mr. Toh and Mr. Mok's concerns are noted, and please relay them to the LDAs and to see how they can respond. Now, we do have strong requests from members, but also a member saying that this may not be necessary. So we are asking the Security Bureau to relay our view to the LDAs. Now, I hope that if resources permit, you should try your best to meet members' requirements. I think we have expressed our views very clearly. Now, for the ISPs, now we have discussed this a lot in the past, and I don't want to labor the point. Mr. James Toh, now, apart from resources, are there other reasons not to comply with our request? What do the LDAs say? Secretary, now, in their day-to-day operation, there are lots of procedures, and they do not maintain statistics for these different procedures. And it seems to me that the LDAs intend to continue doing that because they have to keep figures for other areas. My point is it the time issue, the resource issue, is this the only concern? Now, I was saying that in the day-to-day operation, now in the past, how many witnesses have you made, and how many witness statements have you prepared? They do not keep such figures. Now, I'm asking about warrants to contact the ISPs for information on an annual basis. So do they keep such figures? So there may be tens of thousands of crimes, you know, pickpockets or other thefts and so on, or a number of, you know, domestic fights and so on. So these figures would not be too many. So I don't quite understand what you meant by the other procedural complications. So is there any major principle that they are using to resist our request? Of course, we don't want to make life difficult for them. Is it because they would forget to record such figures? So what is the reason? Now, I don't have a lot to supplement. Now, for technological crime, this aspect is increasing most rapidly. So this is one of the heaviest duties that they're facing today.
Can you give me a rough estimate? Say, for example, technology crimes. How many such crimes a year? Does it? Technology crimes are very complicated. And in applying for a warrant, you just mark two entries, make two entries in the computer. Just take two boxes, and that will do. It's so simple. Earlier on, we gave some numbers of, give the number of technology crimes to the Bills Committee. Well, I think the Bills Committee, I think we can reflect the view of Mr. To and then see if the departments can give you the answer. In fact, there is a paper concerning total number of technology crimes 2013-14, 6,778 cases. So, every time you just make two entries, only when you go to the courts to get a warrant for an IS for the ISPs. I think your point is very clear, Mr. To. Do you have other questions? Yes, please go on. Next time, I hope they can get somebody from the police. Well, maybe you ask the commissioner to come along if he doesn't like to provide the statistics. Paragraph 3. Our 53.1A, the commissioner, I think it is in relation to it is about the relationship between 59.1C and 53.1A. Or 59.1C be subject to any requirement that the commissioner may impose under section 53.1A. How are you going to deal with that? Well, it will be amended. We propose to amend section 59 to spell out clearly that when the protected products are not necessary for the prescribed purpose of the prescribed authorization, then the product will have to be destroyed as soon as possible unless the commissioner has imposed a certain requirement under Section 53.1A. So the requirement made by the commissioner overrides the destruction requirement. Will there be a CSA? No, it's already in the bill. It is, in fact, clause 9 of the blue bill. You don't need the CSA, just clause 19 will suffice. Okay. Yes, you can go on. You can go on. Another 5 minutes, since nobody has asked for the floor. Paragraph 10, Mr. Chairman. Last time, I asked the question, and then you say that those who listen to the products are law enforcement agencies. All designated listeners are officers of the LEA concerned. That's your answer. LEAs have put in place mechanism to make special arrangements for handling different operational scenarios. Now I have given you, well, let me give you an example. There are other possibilities. Say you intercept communication. Say, for example, they use Russian in the communication. Does it mean that the listeners, if you have listeners who understand Russian, then you don't have a problem. But if all your listeners don't understand Russian, then how do you deal with the situation? Though the one who understands Russian is not an officer of the LEA. So will you appoint that person for 2 hours as an officer of the LEA or what? You know, I did ask them a similar question. Say the LEAs may encounter different languages. Sometimes it may be a Chinese dialect, sometimes it may be a foreign language. There is an established arrangement for the police to deal with the situation. Say if you get an interpreter or a translator, then would that be in breach of the rule because this person has access to the secrets? If you look at Section 4 of the ordinance, it is very clear. It said that unless otherwise provided under subsection 4.1, public officers are not allowed to conduct any interception, directly or indirectly. What are the other provisions, subject to what provisions? That includes and the overriding condition is prescribed authorization. That's in Section 4. If there is prescribed authorization, then the person can come into contact with protected products. If we are to tell, what is the arrangement? And what languages do the LEAs understand? We cannot disclose that. That may affect the law enforcement capability. I think Mr. To's concern is that all designated listeners are officers of the LEA concerned. But this statement is different from what is said by the Deputy Secretary. Does it mean that the officer under the prescribed authorization is an officer of the LEA? Will you appoint a person who is not an officer to be an officer for a short period of time, say for 30 minutes, to listen to the product? I think the situation described by the chairman and Mr. To has been covered by Section 4. When such a situation is encountered, arrangement is made under the authorization mechanism so as not to breach the law. So you will make use of the authorization so that the person who listens will become an officer of the LEA. I don't think there is any secret. Well, you may interpret it this way. You may understand it this way. What do you mean? Does it mean that when authorization is given to the police, somebody who is not a police officer is also authorized so that he or she can comply with law? Or the person who listens must be an officer of the police, a police officer, and therefore the commissioner can appoint an interpreter to be a police officer for 1 or 2 days to listen to the interception product? What is the arrangement? Under Section 4, all covert surveillance have to be conducted with authorization. So the situation described by you should also be under authorization, including getting somebody who understands the foreign language. As for how to meet the requirement, that's about the details. Well, it is the question whether the authorization is given by the judge or the authorization is given by the police. The police can appoint somebody for the police to be a police officer for 2 hours. Now, legal advisor. Sorry, I can't hear him. Yes, Chairman. Well, I'll try to provide information to assist Mr. To, and the administration can also supplement. Just now, the Deputy Secretary refers to Section 4, which is a prohibition provision. It says that public officers are not allowed to conduct any interception directly or indirectly unless there is a prescribed authorization. And Section 4 refers to public officer. And the definition of public officer refers to any person holding a salaried office within with the SARG. Well, that's meaningless. Will they just get an interpreter and then appoint the interpreter as a police officer for 2 hours? Who will give the authorization? Legal advisor, can you give me any advice? As for prescribed authorization, it's under the ordinance. It refers to the panel judge. An application is made to the panel judge to obtain authorization. As for public officer, I think Mr. To's concern is, will someone who is listening to the dialogue or communication, and the language is not understood by the public officer, should someone who understands the language be listened to the content of the communication? And if such a person is not a public officer, will there be temporary arrangement to authorize these persons according to the definition of public officer to employ them as public officer of the SARG? That's the question. Maybe the senior law officer can explain. The law enforcement agency can ask non-law enforcement, officers of non-law enforcement agencies or employees of non-law enforcement agencies to discharge duties, to assist them to discharge duties. So they can ask somebody to help them to discharge their duties. But does it include listening to that? Well, if he doesn't understand the language, say if the police doesn't understand the language, then somebody will be employed. But somebody who is not a civil servant will be employed. But during that period, when the person is employed, that person has become an employee of the government. The interpreter may not be present in the government department. Mr. Khan.
Chair, now in helping the LEA for, let's say, a passage of translation, he or she will become a public official. Now, the LEAs will, in its day-to-day operation, will have a need for translation. And by doing the translation, the translator does not become a public official. Now, it says that all those listening to the materials would be public officials. Now, we are looking at paragraph 10, I believe. The actual listening would be done by a special group or dedicated unit. and the designated listeners are officers of the LDA. But if there are special situation, we will have special arrangement. Yes, I'm asking about the special arrangement. So try not to answer in this way. Otherwise, you're misleading me. So while listening to languages that you don't understand, are you going to ask a translator for help? So the designated listeners are not all officers. Chair, now I hope Mr. To will understand that there are different situations because there are many languages in the world, and within the police force, there are people knowing different languages, but we do not ask them to do the same designated listeners. No, I'm asking about what Mr. Kan is saying. You ask a translator to help, right? And in that situation, are you going to hire the translator to become an officer for 1 or 2 days? Or are you going to get court authority to empower somebody who is not a policeman to do the listening? And what level of approval is needed? Now, Mr. To, I believe you understand that the detail of the operation cannot be divulged. But if we are looking at paragraph 4, if we need to rely on others to help, the application will have to be made very, very clear. Otherwise, the approval cannot be given. And then the commissioner would actually find that there is irregularity. So in the application for authority, well, in these cases are a few and far between. I'm not talking about a few or far between. Now, my question is still not being answered. So for example, you know that the target speaks English or Urdu or some other languages, then you can ask the panel judge for the approval to be given. But sometimes if there is a certain passage involving a certain dialect that you don't understand, do you have to go back to the panel judge for a modified authority so that non-officers can continue listening? Or whether it is going to be, as Mr. Kan said, you can ask somebody who knows that language to just listen to that passage. But then if that is the case, it will violate paragraph 10. And will you also be violating the law? And then if you are violating the law, what are you going to do about it? Now, after asking about paragraph 10, I'm going to ask about the commissioner. But I would like to ask about this part first. I don't understand why you are not answering the question directly and just say that this is not really answered in a direct way. So who can actually give the authority, the judge or the police? Now, if Mr. To really wants to know the details, now, we do have special arrangement. Now, if you want to have further information, I believe we have to ask the LEAs and to give you a response in writing. But operational confidentiality is something we have to respect. Now, on how to seek external help, we're going to ask them how they go about it. Okay, moving on to the commissioner now. Now, you are saying that the commissioner can listen, okay, not the police. And the commissioner only has a limited pool of people to work with him. And if the commissioner needs external help, and what sort of delegation does he have? What sort of scope does he have? Now, on the language issue, now the commissioner at the moment is an expatriate, and he or she relies on the help of the secretariat to deal with the language issues. Now, in future, if, let's say, there is a non-language or an exotic language being used, I would again include this in my written response to you, Mr. To. We have to consult the commissioner. Now, there are two different scenarios. Now, the commissioner only has the power written here. And there might be a kind of a bottleneck which require further amending in the future, and that's something I wish to avoid. Okay, so a written response will be given. Now, if there are no further questions, I'm sorry, Chair. On paragraph 6, I think I've asked several times. There are four LDAs. Can you tell us, do they have any reason for a different time for destroying the materials? Yes, the question has been asked, but well, it's 1 month for all four LDAs. Well, it's not going to be different if it's 1 month for all. So that's why I was asking. Now, generally speaking, it's 1 month. Now, how come that one requires, say, 3 weeks, and then another department or another LDA requires a month and a half? So what is the reason for that? Okay, see if you can answer Mr. To's question. Yeah, I don't understand why this is so secretive. No, we are not trying to hide anything, Chair. Now, under the law, the heads of departments are empowered to have his own policy on destruction of these materials. So the four LDAs, the four department heads, will have their own policies. And I have to say it here again, in its actual operation, they or will destroy the materials within 1 month if the information is no longer needed. Sometimes they do it in 2 or 3 weeks' time, and they do not exceed 1 month. I think Mr. To's question is really very simple. Can you give us the specific answer for the four LDAs? Maybe you don't even have to tell us the name of the departments. Is there one requiring 45 days? Is there another one requiring 27 days? And yet a third requiring 14 days? Can you provide such information for the four departments and the reasons? Can you provide those? Yes, well, even 1 day is within 1 month. So the within 1 month is not really very meaningful. So there may be a difference between 1 day and 29 days. It is within 1 month. Yes, I think the expression within 1 month is meaningful. Yes, I understand your view. Okay. The practice has been done for 9 years, and they have all told me that 1 month after the operation, the product will be destroyed. And there seems to be a consensus here But do the four LDAs do it differently? Are there any differences? Now, we do not have access to their secret information. Now, I don't understand, Chair. Now, if one department uses 29 days, another uses 28 days, why is that confidential? Well, what tea bag I am drinking, that would not be confidential, I don't think, whether it is Lipton or another tea company. I think the question is very simple. So tell us the four LEAs, A, B, C, D, how many days do they need? So it's really a very simple question. The member is not happy with the answer within 1 month. And also the reason, Mr. Chairman, you are saying that the head of department can have his own policy, but you as the coordinating body, and you come here to answer the question on their behalf, right? So you are the coordinating body, and you know that they have different times for this particular issue. Now, do you feel that under a reasonable scenario, it might be easier to explain to the public if they have the same duration, rather than leaving it to them to say how many days they require? Deputy Secretary, now the four LEAs have different work areas, and they have their own guidelines. Now, we understand that for the protected products, they are consistent in the destruction of the products. Now, for Mr. Toh's request, maybe I would give you a further reply in writing. Okay, we move on now to clause-by-clause scrutiny. So let's look at the long title now. Now, who would lead us for this discussion? Yes, Ms. Ng. Now, if you have the bill, then now we have the long title listing the purpose. So we have the amendment raised by previous commissioners. So basically, it's for the commissioner to have access to these protected materials. And we have provided some technical suggestions as well in the past. Can I ask the legal advisor? Now, submission of bills to LegCo recently. Now, the wording is now really very, very narrow. And there is very little room for amendment. Is this a general observation? Now, in the past, it's just one sentence, but now it's a very long the sentence. So do we have a trend here? Now, Mr. Toh, in recent years, Mr. Toh's viewpoint has been expressed on past occasions that in the long title, there seems to be a trend to be rather detailed. And if members recall, past bills, say in the 90s, the long title is really very simple. The bill aims to amend a certain bill and other consequential amendments. But whether or not in the last few months or in the last few years, all the bills have this particular trend, I really cannot say for sure. Now, but I can only say that Mr. Toh's concern has been raised on similar occasions in the past. And there seems to be an observation that the long title is really very, very detailed, so that members sometimes would feel that the room for maneuver is very much limited. Chair, now, the long title. Now, I'm just giving an example. Can I first of all amend the long title? And if that is approved, and then we delay the submission of the bill before introducing the CSAs. Now, the short answer is really no, Mr. Toh. Now, because under the Section 57 of the Rules of Procedures, and you will understand that the related committee stage amendments will have to be within the scope or outside the scope, and the chair will look at the scope, and one of which would be the long title considered by the chairman, and the chairman would also consider the electrical brief provided by the government, as well as to look at the explanatory memorandum of the bill, as well as the related wording and other related factors. So the chairman will have to decide the scope of the bill. And now for the long title, as to when it can be amended.
The principle is that with regard to the CSAs in respect of the substantive provisions leading to consequential amendments of the long title, then the long title can be amended. Generally speaking, according to the view of the President of the Council, if a member submits a substantive CSA, the wording will have to be decided, or rather the ruling will have to be made by the President whether it's allowed or not. It will be to amend the substantive provisions first and then consequentially amend the long title instead of going the other way around. So to put simply, the answer is no. My point is, I amend the long title. I only submit one CSA, and that is to amend the long title. If it is endorsed, then we can adjourn the bill, and then adjourn the passage of the bill, and then we can amend, make further CSAs. The simple answer is no. Now, the long title can only be amended consequential to the substantive CSAs. If you just amend the long title to expand the scope of the bill, then usually that will not be approved by the President. I don't know whether the legal advisor was referring to 57(4A). It is about the scope, or is also about relevance. Basing on the advice given, Mr. Toh doesn't need to do that. As long as he can do something that is in line with the question, and if the long title has become an impediment, then the long title can be amended in a consequential manner. Is that the case? Yes, Mr. Chair is right. The ROP is 57(4A). The amendment has to be in line with the subject of the bill. As for the amendment of the long title, it is 58(9). The amendment will be done when the substantive amendments have become part of the bill. And then the long title becomes a consequential amendment. But if the amendments moved by the CSA, moved by a member, is outside the scope of the bill, then that amendment will not be allowed by the president. And if the amendment is not allowed, then there can be no way to amend the long title. If you just amend the long title so as to expand the scope of the bill, so that certain CSAs, which should not have been allowed generally, the president will not allow the amendment to the long title. Under 57.4a, apart from the long title, the provisions in the bill can also be amended. If it is not too far-fetched, then you can amend the you can introduce the amendment, you can introduce a CSA, and after you've introduced the CSA, then you can also amend the long title. Legal advisor, it depends on the specific CSA, and finally the decision is by the president. The president, in considering whether a CSA can be allowed, will take into many account, many factors, say whether the provision, the CSA is relevant to the provisions. I want to ask the legal advisor, concerning members' CSAs, members moving the CSAs, and the CSA stand part of the bill, and then the long title can be amended then. Does it apply to the government CSAs? Or certain rules are relaxed in respect of the CSAs removed by the administration? Legal advisor, I think the provisions are equally, the ROPs applies both to members and the administration, as far as the CSAs are concerned. Now say, for example, if the long title is narrow, now suppose we convince the administration, and the administration can is willing to move a CSA, but it is restricted by the long title. Then the administration will have to move another bill, right? Yes, the answer is yes. In the past, if you can recall, there was a building amendments ordinance. It's about the window and building inspections. The administration wanted to move a CSA, but because of ROP 57.4a, the administration was not able to move a certain CSA. The administration had to move another bill, move another amendment bill. If you don't have any other questions on long title, let us move on. The first one, clause one, is short title. The ordinance may be cited as Interpretation of Communications and Surveillance Amendment Ordinance 2015. Mr. James Toh, I find it strange. Where is the commencement date? Is it put somewhere at the back? You need to make preparations, right? You need a commencement date, don't you? Yes, the Assistant Secretary. We have not appointed a commencement date. If there is no commencement date, then when the bill is enacted into law by third reading in the council and then gazetted, then it comes into effect. We want to give the power to the commissioner ASAP, and therefore we do not appoint a commencement date. Legal advisor, if no commencement date is written in the bill under Cap 1, Section 20, once the bill is enacted into law and gazetted, then it comes into effect. Don't you need the manpower, additional manpower? Don't you need training? While we are preparing the bill, The commissioner is actively making his preparation. He will slightly augment his the manpower of his office. And after the bill is passed into law, then there will be decisions in respect of authorization and also arrangements for destructions. What about the standing orders? Will they be amended? The standing orders, the codes, the guidelines will be amended, but the scale of amendment will not be too big. All right, if there's no question on clause one, and then we'll move on with the aid of the markup copy, CB2-1172-1415(3). Interpretation, page 1. Now, clause 3 is to amend section 2, interpretation. They are to empower the judge withdraw part of the authorization. That is in respect of executive authorization, in respect of the judge authorization, a device, retrieval, warrants, so on and so forth. Some parts of the authorization can be revoked, some parts can remain. 2-1. Maybe you follow, you tell us which part is added and which part is deducted or deleted. Please follow the markup copy under 2-1. In respect of executive authorization and where the context requires includes an executive authorization to be issued or renewed under the division and B, an executive authorization has been partially revoked under Part 5. Well, I don't know. I find it a bit confused. Now, there is an executive authorization. There is a certain scope, a big circle. Suddenly, you have found that you want a smaller circle. Then you will revoke the original authorization. If you have already revoked that authorization, then it is no longer an executive authorization. Why the executive authorization end? What is the word end there? Mrs. Ng, executive authorization refers to type 2 surveillance or covert surveillance. Say if the authorization is to conduct surveillance at three different locations. When they continue the work, maybe according to Part 5, at one location, under Section 57, there is no need to monitor this place. So they will cancel Place A. And then they will report to the authority. Then the authority can revoked location A, withdraw location A, but locations B and C, the authorization still exists. There's still an executive authorization. Then
the authorization, well, should really be taken away, but your linking word is and, or cup in Chinese. So, can you please clarify whether it is the A that should go missing? those that have not been deleted. Now, the B should follow Section 5, then the remaining. Now, you are saying that executive authorization should include the that has been revoked. Now, okay, let me check the English version. Now, the translation is correct. So what you are saying is the those that remain do not include the revoked parts. But it now the original includes the revoked part. So I don't know whether I'm confused. Now, the of course is the one that has that remains. Now the English one is
睇咧就係嗰個行政授權嚟嘅，咁嗰個行政授權咧就係被局部撤銷咗。
So the English seems to be clearer. So the executive part has been revoked in part. So there is one part that is still remaining. So the legal advisor, is it clear to you? Maybe I am a bit confused. Yes. So does it actually achieve the goal it aims to achieve? Now, if we understand correctly, and as the government explains, or as Mr. Toh says, that the part that has not been revoked will still be included. Now, it seems that the English version is easier to understand. The Chinese, if you read it again, it may give the impression whether the revoked part should retain in the original. So maybe we should look at the wording to see whether it can be improved. Because the partially revoked part will be retained. So there might be this misunderstanding. Yes, thank you for your view, so we can take it back to see whether any amendment can be done. Next, the judge's authorization, the definition, and then similarly, the emergency authorization are similar. And the next page, well, maybe you should do it one by one. First of all, the judge's authorization, we should add B. That is a judge's authorization that has been partially revoked under Part 5. Okay, any question on this part? Now, just to be safe, now the executive authorization and the judge's authorization and the part on partial revocation, now the concept is the same. Yeah, that's correct. Now, for the executive authorization, well, see if the wording can be made even clearer. Yes, we'll go back and consider that. Yes, see if this can be expressed even more clearly. Now, moving on to page 2, device retrieval warrant. This really is the same as the previous one. We add section B, so following section 38A, a device retrieval warrant that has been partially revoked. So this is a new addition to empower the panel judge to revoke the device retrieval warrant, either in whole or in part. So there is a revocation amendment to partially revoke the retrieval warrant. I'm just trying to recall, why do you have to revoke partially? Is that the same as a new application? Can you give us some examples? And what is the difference between a partial revocation and a new application? Or if you were to use a mobile phone as an example. Chair, this is the suggestion of a previous commissioner. The suggestion was that when an LEA asks for an authorization, say for two locations or three locations or two different telephone devices, and you have to assess very, very clearly whether something does not fulfill the third condition, or if one of the telephone line, one of the target has already been rounded up, and a report has to be made. And the past commissioner is of the view that the panel judge has no power to partially revoke the situation. So the suggestion was that he should be able to do it in part or in whole. So the panel judge at the moment only has the power to revoke the whole thing. But now the suggestion is that the panel judge should be allowed to partially revoke the issue. So the panel judge now has a wider power to handle the reports that he or she obtained. And of course, there are different scenarios when reports are submitted. But the spirit is that the judge now has a finer power to do things. Yes, I understand the spirit, but the wording in Chinese is a bit clumsy. Now, the usual way is that the part of the wording doesn't, if removed, does not affect the whole clause. Now, so for the English,
renew under Division 3 or Part 3, whether, notwithstanding, sort of, 說他是 partially revoked 之類, 在源頭上說, amendments 上去這樣說,
so this way, using a general provision, if there's a partial revocation, the whole bill is not affected. Now, is this going to be a very major move? I'm just trying to help by suggesting a way to simplify things. Any response? We can go back to see how the drafting can be improved. James Toh. I understand Mr. Jay's point. It's really a legal point, not a drafting point. If you look at number 5, you have to do a certain thing to revoke. Now, an example. If there are three locations, and if you mess up one location, the location is no longer there. It no longer exists, let's say. Now, the effect would be that the whole thing is nullified. But now you have to do a positive action. The action may require supporting document. You have to convince the judge that you have to revoke this because the location is no longer there. So the person has already moved. So that may actually be clearer if you have to take an active action, rather than something becoming redundant. Yes, I think you should look at this more carefully, as Mr. Toh suggested. Now, I cannot extend the meeting any longer, I'm afraid. Now, members have expressed views, so next meeting we will continue on page 3, but there are no amendments there, so we'll actually start on page 4. So this wraps up our meeting. We have no AOB items, and I will inform members regarding the date of next meeting. So meeting is now adjourned. Thank you.